along with me by saying, I believe that I am.
I believe that I am.
What my Bible says that I am.
What my Bible says that I am.
Now, if my Bible says it.
If my Bible says it.
I have a right to say it.
I have a right to say it.
My Bible says.
My Bible says.
That I am an heir of God.
I am an heir of God.
Join heirs with Jesus.
Join heirs with Jesus.
That makes me want to shout.
That makes me want to shout.
Everybody loud.
Hallelujah.
My mind's alert.
My mind's alert.
My heart is open.
My heart is open.
And we're going to
praise the Lord.
Brother Barry.
While I was singing, somebody touched me. While I was singing, somebody touched me. While I was singing, somebody touched me.
Now, if you want to get to standing back up later, that's fine with me. David, hit me a little bit of that, bless that wonderful name and see with that boogie woogie beat.
Well, bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Yes, now bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Yes, now. Name I know. Well, there's power in
one time.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let's say it one more time.
Hallelujah.
Now, I've done this from time to time, but I want the preacher to tell us about hallelujah one more time. Tell us what that means, preacher. Hallelujah.
Amen.
My pleasure. Hallelujah is the biggest, tallest, baddest form of praising God. That is the greatest form of praising God. Even the angelic hosts say hallelujah.
Yeah.
So if you don't know how to praise God, and things are at a point where you can't figure out how that you're getting close to God, it ain't working, you just start calling hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
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 Say it
hallelujah.
One more time. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you.
Bless
David.
That wonderful name of Jesus.
Yeah, now bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Well, now bless that wonderful name.
This morning.
Yeah.
Well, praise Him. Praise Him. Yeah, praise Him in the morning. Praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him.
Praise Him.
Yeah, praise Him when the sun goes down. Well, now love Him.
Love Him.
Yes, now love Him in the morning. Can you tell God you love Him this morning?
We love you, Lord.
We love you, Lord.
Love you, Lord.
We praise you and we say hallelujah to you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. David?
Yes.
Let's do something else about like that. Don't you all love when David gets to come to our church?
Amen.
Preach, David.
Well,
he can do it.
I'm just glad to know that I serve a Redeemer.
Yeah.
Yes.
Who loves me and cares enough for me that He sent His Son on Calvary. Yes. That whosoever believes on Him would not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. I'm so glad that I have a Redeemer who cares enough for me that He took stripes on His back.
Yes.
That I could be healed.
Yeah.
I'm so glad that I have a Redeemer who loved me enough that He faced all of everything that we have to face and yet came out without sin.
Yeah.
I'm so glad I have a Redeemer whose name is Jesus Christ.
Hey.
And yeah. If you're here this morning and you don't know Him, oh my goodness, what are you waiting
Come on,
for?
Man. Come on.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing with the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Yes, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face,
yeah,
is before me. I can only imagine. Yes, I can only imagine.
Gonna be great.
Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Yeah, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Oh, yeah. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, ever worship you. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine.
Can you give him praise this morning? Can you tell him you love him? Wow. Boy, he sure loved us, didn't he? He sure loves us, right? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to come down here to earth, die on a cross, be the ultimate sacrifice, the only sacrifice that can cover our sins. Is that right? Amen. Man, that's love, isn't it? I'm going to get our pastor to come up. Old Bobby said, he put something up there, I got an awesome pastor. And boy, we do. Let's give it up for our pastor one time. I'm going to ask him to do us a favor. We had a good time with Marla's sister, is down with us from Eastern Kentucky. Tammy's back there. And so, it just popped in my mind. You know, when you get 56 years old, things just pop in your mind. But we're so glad to have Tammy with us this week.
Amen.
But while Marla sings this song, if anybody has a prayer request, I think all we need to do is just raise your hand. Hey, you know what? Guess what? We don't even have to know, because God knows. He's a heart knower. Is that right?
Right.
Does he know what we're thinking? We can pray to him in our mind. I think he likes to hear it out loud. So if you got a prayer request, just have it on your mind. Just acknowledge by raising your hand that you got a prayer request. While Marla sings this song right here. And anyway. Yeah.
Direct line to the throne room.
I'll just say there is power in prayer. You can come on. I just want to say so many prayers have been answered at this church, and I'm very thankful this morning. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Can somebody say thank you, Lord?
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Your pastor is a strange kook. I heard the amens. It's okay. And there's times that when I try to pray, and I don't, y'all let them alone. They're just getting ready for a song. I don't know how to pray. I'll be truthful with you. If there was ever a guy that knew how to pray, my dad knew how to pray. And dad only knew how to pray one way, and it was loud. I'm talking about he only prayed loud. And he and I were praying in Newark, Ohio. We get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, we go to pray. And I'd end up going to the basement of the church because Dad only knew one way to pray, screaming at the top of his lungs. And he never knew if there was nobody there. That's just the way he prayed. And I would find myself as he would say, "Oh, God, so-and-so, so-and-so." And I'd say, yes, that's a good one, Lord. And he'd say, "Oh, Lord, don't forget. Oh, yeah, we need that too, God." That I would forget that I'm supposed to pray. So Dad says to me one day, he says, "I see that you're not there when I pray. Where are you going?" I said, "Dad, I'm going to the basement." He said, "Have I offended you?" I said, "Oh, no, Dad." I said, I forget to pray. I just start encouraging you. Prayer is something you can't imagine. Don't look at it as an asking opportunity. Can I teach you that? Don't look at it as a time that I need. There is those times. Don't misunderstand me. But look at it as a time of learning about your master, your creator, your father. Would you not, if you had a great relationship with your parents or someone you love, wouldn't you just give anything to be able to spend 10 minutes with them and they may be gone? Warren Buffett, one of the richest guys in all the world, they asked him, said, "If you could pay something, Warren, if you could buy," I was there, I listened to it. "Warren, if you could buy something you can't buy, what would it be?" You know what he said? 10 minutes with my dad. And we have the opportunity to spend more than 10 minutes with the creator of all things because he desires for you to spend it with him. Okay?
Praise the Lord.
I'm learning so much. It's a cool thing. I'm 65 and still learning so much about the more. Let me rephrase that. I'm learning more about God than I knew. How's that? It's either me or this is hot. Is it too hot? Too hot to channel. I'm learning a new prayer. And may I share it with you so that you could try. There are times that we pray selfishly. Anybody ever prayed selfishly? Three times in the last 2 months, I have asked for selfish prayers. And I've literally said it, in fact, I think two or three times on Wednesday night, I'm asking for a selfish prayer. A selfish prayer. And this last time, it was so incredible to me that God answered it. I must share it with you. And the selfish prayer was that my mother would know who I was. Okay? It went further. So on the way to Florida, I said, "Lord, I'm asking for a selfish prayer. I want to remind you that I want Mom to know me." I said, "Let's go further, that she knows her grandchildren, that wow. She knows this and that. Would you please?" And it was remarkable to me. She knew who I was, and she had been calling Dad, that man that was your dad, instead of saying my husband, you know, calling by his name, El. She has been saying, you know, that man that was your father. She called Dad by his name and remembered things and how we and El got together. Now, to you, that's nothing. To me, it was incredible. She called every one of her grandchildren by name.
Wow.
And I am reminded that God is a man that loves his children.
Amen.
Of whom I am one, and so are you. Indulge that. I thank you that you understand. For those of you that have never experienced those kind of things when family members doesn't know who you are, hang on. It does seem to attach it. I never thought that that day would come, but I thank God that he hears and answers prayer. Not always the way you want it, but the way he needs it. I think the song is, he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. A few announcements, and we're going to get moving. I know that a lot of you are aware that another beloved pastor in Hopkinsville has come down with the coronavirus. Strange that it seems to be attacking those that are in need of God, or those that are shepherds. So when you hit your knees, do you know what that term means? Hit your knees means when you pray. And I trust that every one of you hit your knees. You better not depend on Steve to get to heaven. You better not depend on Chris to get to heaven. Huh? Because when you get to heaven, you can't say, well, Chris and Steve should have prayed for me. No. You better depend on you. So when you hit your knees at night, would you remember the ministers in this community? Okay? Good. A great gospel sing coming up a week from Monday night.
Yeah, I think that's right. Jason's going to tell you all about it.
Okay.
All right, we're going to have Freddie Redmond from Tennessee. Now, we've already got Al going from Tennessee, and so he's really the star of the show. But we're used to having Al our pal, and we're awful glad to have him. So we're bringing some more people from Tennessee. So Freddie Redmond is gonna come, and he's gonna bless your socks off. This guy, he's kind of a one man band. He sits around with his he sits there with his flat top guitar, and he's got a little vocalizer and a couple tracks or something that he might sing with. But usually it's just him and his guitar, and he's really got a nice voice, nice personality, a wife, a beautiful little baby. He's gonna come up and introduce to you. And I'm awful excited to get to see him, and I hope that you'll come out and support us on the Monday night Bobby Rich Fest, Bobby Rich Monday Night Music Fest, next Monday night, the 26th.
It's going to be good.
Be good. Make sure. Yeah. There you go. Next Sunday after church, right here, we're going to have a baptism at the lake, at the river. So Brother Chris is going to take care of that. I guess, are we going to do what we have in the past, or how are you going to do it, Chris? I'm talking to you. He's got his headsets on. So you want to eat a little soup and sandwich here? Okay, we're going to have a little soup and sandwich, so bring something, and from here we'll go to the river and be baptized. For those of you that are not interested in being baptized in the river, hang on. Brother Deacon Glenn and Chris are going to build us a wonderful pavilion out there. And included in the pavilion is a baptistry for yours truly. So for those that want to be baptized in the river, and there's a bunch. There's probably more that want to be baptized in the river than not. You're going to be baptized in the river by Pastor Chris. And those that want to be baptized, you'll be baptized by me. So that'll work out good. Would you please stand? I am excited today. Are you excited? Yes. Amen. Wednesday night, we're doing it. We've had a number of people say, Steve, will you do it? And I'm going to do it. We're going to teach on the end times and what the news is affecting today, how it comes out of the end times. You asked for it. We're going to do it. So I took a vote last week, and it was overwhelmingly. So we're going to start teaching on end time prophecy and how it affects today's news, not just end-time prophecy. I'm going to bring it in while it affects today's news. If you see it in operation, you see this scripture says so-and-so, and you look back and go, whoa, that's happening right now. That kind of encourages your faith. We are in the last days. Are we in the last days?
Amen.
When we get ready to leave today, there's pans in the front. We used to make a big deal about hugging, and one day we will. One day that's going to get back. Steve, I'm saying it by faith, because right now it doesn't look like that's ever going to happen. So by faith, I'm saying one day we're going to get to do what we used to do.
We will.
Yes, we will.
We will. Okay? But we're going to take up the offering at the end, and I have a sermon on where are the miracles today. And that sermon at the end, we're going to pray for people that needs a blessing from God and a touch from God. Okay? So I'm not forgetting ministry time. I want you to hear the sermon and hope it increases your faith so that when we do pray, you will be able to hear from God as well, okay? But would you make Sister Sydney welcome right now?
There are loved ones up in glory whose dear voices you often miss when you close your earthly story. Will you join them in their bliss? Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by, in a better home awaiting, in the sky, Lord, in the sky, in the joyous days of childhood, oft they told of wondrous love, pointed to the dying Savior. Now they dwell with him above. Will the circle be unbroken?
Peggy. Peggy has a testimony. The book of Revelations teaches us about testimony. What does it say? Yeah. They said, who are these people? Who are these people? John is so cool. John the Beloved is so cool. Because probably John didn't know who it was. And John said the right thing. He said, thou knowest who they are. And the angel says, oh yeah, that's right. These were overcomers. How were they overcomers? By the blood of the Lamb and the word of their... Try it again. How were they overcomers? By the blood of the Lamb and the word of their
testimony.
Thank you. Sister Peggy's giving a testimony. Will you say thank you, Sister Peggy?
Thank you.
Well, I got up this morning to find Dominic had a temperature. Wasn't a high temperature, but you know immediately what went into my mind. We've brought the COVID into him. So I started praying. I went in the kitchen and I told God, if this is what it is, then I'm going to trust you. I'm going to walk with you. You'll take us through it. And if you have to take him home, then you'll get us through that too. So I went and sat down in my chair and he said, the Holy Spirit said to me, put on prayer warriors. And I said, now, there's no need to put on prayer warriors. I done talked to God. Everything's covered. He said, put it on prayer warriors, which is a group that I have. So I immediately typed in my prayer that he had this small fever, and we were worried. And then I went into the bedroom where he was, like 2 minutes, to change his breathing treatment out, and I looked over at the monitor, and his heart rate's down. That's how you can tell if Dom has a temperature. When I had left the room, it was like 139. When I walked in, it was 82. I got the thermometer out, and he had went from 100.6 to 98.6. Now, that's what happens when you do what God tells you to do.
Have your Bibles, you know, join with me to the book of Genesis. Thank you, Lord. I am just learning how to use this thing. See, but I was smart. I had a backup copy just in case. As I have told you, something interesting happened concerning Mom, my mother, and for our visitors. Hey, good, pretty good crowd today. I'm grateful that you come. Looks like more and more people are coming. Praise the Lord. I am doing something that you may think I'm crazy. I'll be truthful with you. I think I'm crazy. Kenny, I think I'm crazy. Anybody know the story of Ezekiel and the dry bones? You know, I want y'all to understand something. Y'all need to start getting in the Word. I remember the old timers when I was just a kid, and they would testify, and they would always say, stay in. Y'all try that one time just for me. Imitate an old woman or an old man. Stay in the Word. Here we go. On three. One, two, three. Stay in the Word. And now I are one. And I used to make fun of those old timers. Stay in the Word. Now I understand. A lot of you, I could say, turn to the book of Hezekiah and you'd grab your Bibles and try to find it, wouldn't you? Hezekiah sounds like a book of the Bible. It ain't. Huh? That's because you're not in the Word enough. Don't depend on Chris to be in the Word. Don't depend on Steve Terry to be in the Word. Don't depend on Barry Potter to be in the Word. You better start getting in the Word. That's reproach from your pastor. And I told you Mom was doing good and started remembering things, and it was just her and I had the pleasure of being with her about 6 hours by myself. And she said to me something strange, you know, because when they get dementia or stroke or however you want to say it, they reminisce by days gone by. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Okay. And they reminisce by days gone by. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You understand what I'm saying now. For our young people, they hit it and never stop. It's continuous. But she was in a different frame of mind. Stephan, it's good to see you, the whole family. You look good. Well, the girls do anyway. And she said to me, do you remember Sister Annie? God, help me get through this. The name rang a bell, but I couldn't quite do it. She said, you need to hear this, Steve. I said, okay, Mom. Sister Annie was the one that played the guitar with three strings. And here's the story. My dad had taken a church at the age of 19. They had about 15 people. Mom was 16. Can you imagine if your pastor was 19 years old and the pastor's wife was 16? It was a holiness church. What does that mean? That means that the women didn't go to church without wearing hose. It was a sin. You didn't go bare-skinned. The men didn't have their clothes covered their face, covered their arms. It was a holiness church. So mom would wear hose that had runs and hose in them because they didn't have any money. His first year in full-time ministry, he made less than $300. His second year, he got a bump up to $524. 21 days, they lift off a Hard Rock Christmas candy because that's all there was. That's all there was. Now, we got it tough in ministry, don't we? So God had blessed Dad with a church in Aliceville, Alabama. That's where your pastor was born. Trivia question. Things were moving. Things were great. Things were going, Jimmy, they were going magnificent. The church grew. Dad and Mom built a house. Dad had a brand new car. He was now the big shot in big time Aliceville, Alabama. Now, by now, he's probably 21, 22. And it was time to go to the bank and deposit his weekly check. And he took his brand new car. And as he went to the brand around the corner, there was Sister Annie. In those days, they didn't have a lot of money for dental stitching. She had holes in her teeth and gaps in her teeth. And she played a 3-string guitar, which needed 6 strings. And Dad said, oh, no, no, no. Because when I get out, people are going to associate me with Sister Annie. No, God, thou wouldn't want your favorite son to be. No, 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 no. So Dad started driving around the block, hoping that Sister Annie, because she's a street preacher. What do we call those? There used to be a name, and I'm not being funny, like a street preacher. Maybe that's what it is. What? There's a term, maybe somebody will pick it up. But that's how you preached. You got on the street corner and you started preaching. We had one for years right here in Madisonville. Went on to be with the Lord, I think, was last year. And he could preach. I listened to him. That man could preach. And it is, as nobody stops and listens to street preachers, you just, you know, you kind of hear. And one of the greatest preachers I ever heard was a street preacher in Hawaii. I mean, that guy was putting it down. And Sister Annie wanted to be a singer. Have you ever heard somebody want to be a singer that shouldn't be a singer? Oh, yeah, that was not Sister Annie's calling. But guitar playing wasn't either, Barry. She only had 3 strings. And none of them were in any kind of tune now. She just strung. So Dad drove around the block thinking, oh, this is not going to be good. People associate. She goes to my church. She's, oh, Lord, please. So Dad drove around the block 3 times. He used it as an excuse that there was no parking places. And finally, there was a parking place, and guess where it was? Her guitar case, the old beat-up thing, when they opened it up, the back end of it was leaning against his front wheel. Dad was embarrassed. Here he is, pastoring maybe the most prominent church in Aliceville, Alabama. Him just a young man, and this woman, and he literally told me the story of how he put his head on his steering wheel and said, oh God, this is an embarrassment to your children. Not only embarrasses me, it's got to embarrass you. Look at this woman. She don't need to be doing anything for you. Surely you can call her to do something else. Not to sing and think she's a preacher because she ain't a singer, she ain't a preacher. And Dad said he heard the voice of the Lord and said, look up, you idiot, look up. And he looked up and 3 grown men in business suits were in front of that guitar case giving their heart to the Lord. We don't see that anymore, do we? My question to you today is, where are the miracles that we saw when we were younger? They don't exist anymore. God's changed his mind. Where are those that used to get saved by driving a truck and hearing it on the radio, and they'd pull their 18-wheelers over and get out of the truck and get on their knees on the concrete and give their heart to the Lord? Happened to me. I had my Sunday school teacher, Angus Autry. He was a truck driver. He heard the call of God. He stopped his 18-wheeler and got out, gave his heart to the Lord right there on the hard concrete. Where are those days that we see people being saved, touched, healed by the power of God? Worldly. Is it us? Has God changed? I don't believe so. I don't believe so. He said he's the same yesterday, today, and so it's got to be too easy to go to the hospital. I'm included. Pop down my $15. They don't even ask me for money anymore. Just pop down my insurance card. Too easy. Well, Steve, it looks like you got the sniffles. We find an interesting story in Genesis chapter 22. When I give you scripture, and it's about individuals, I want you to put my idea is that you put yourself in this individual's place. That's what my idea is. We find that God has a man that he says that it was his friend. How would you like to be a friend of God? Huh? Now be realistic. Only time in the Bible it said that somebody was God's friend. The whole Bible. One Bible. All 66 books. One man was a friend of God that we know of. His name was Abraham. How would you like to have that title? Huh? Pretty cool. Those of you like certain people, I know we got some people here that like the President Trump. Can you imagine if they said, that guy's a friend of President Trump? I got an acquaintance that's a little off on occasion. And they live in another world sometimes. You, anybody ever associated with those people? Don't, you got to wave your hand at me. There's nobody taking pictures. Relax. Nobody's taking pictures. And suddenly this individual that I know knows people that, yeah, right. I worked with a guy one time that was that way, and my boss kept coming in. Raymond, he came to me every day. How's he working? How's he doing? He's doing okay. He was just a helper. How's he doing? Was everybody okay? He's fine. About the fifth day, I said, what's going on? Nothing. Sixth day come around. Suddenly I understood why he was asking me, because suddenly the guy was saying, I guess I need to talk to the president. And I said, what? Well, Russia is going to be in Cuba next week, and they plan on taking over America. So I probably need to call the president and let him know what I found out. And I said, you talking about the president of the United States? Well, of course. What other president is there? I've been undercover for weeks now, coming and collecting all this information. I'm being truthful with you, Sarge. I'm being truthful with you. I'm going, okay. And I went into my boss. He and I, he was full-blooded Italian, straight from the boat. I said, Dominic, the guy's crazy. He said, he didn't take his medicine. I said, what? He has to take medicine, man. He got to take medicine. I'm going to tell you that, can you imagine somebody says that they were a friend of God? Abraham was a friend of God. And God had promised him a son. Now he's 100 years old. His wife's 90 years old. And God had promised him a son with Sarah. And even Sarah laughed at God. And God said, he said, well, I didn't laugh at you. Yeah, you did. I heard you laugh, he said. So we find that God's given him a son. We know the son, his name is Isaac. He is the father Abraham, father Isaac, father Jacob of the tribe of Israel. And God has said to him, verse 22, chapter 22, verse 1. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. Wait a second, what? That was called test. And God did test Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, behold, here am I. Too often today, we don't know the voice of God, do we? Do we? The Bible says, my sheep know my voice. We're still lambs. And Abraham said, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest. Whoa. Whom thou lovest. And get thee into a land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains, which I shall tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men and Isaac his son and cleaved the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went into the place which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place far off. And Abraham said unto the young men, abide here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Question one, paragraph one, faith one. Now God has said to Abraham, you're going to offer him up. But what did he tell the boys? We're coming again. We're coming again. And Abraham took the wood, the burnt offering, and laid it upon Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they both went together. And Isaac said unto Abraham his father, my father? And he said, here I am, my son. He said, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering. So they both went together. And there they came into a place which God had told him of, and Abraham built the altar, laid the wood in the order, and bound his Isaac his son. Many scholars believe at this time Isaac's 14. Now, Abraham's an old guy. We know he's old. And the unique thing is that they believe that Isaac so trusted his daddy that he listened to his daddy. We're guessing. We don't have it in the word. We don't know. But a 14-year-old generally can whip a 100-year-old. A 114-year-old. Huh? What we find out is that he started to reach down and take his knife and kill his own son. And God said, stop. And an angel of the Lord came and grabbed the knife. And there was a ram. And they offered up the ram. And God said, now I know that you love me more than the son. Today, we got to ask the question, do we love God enough to see the miracles in our life? Do we love God enough to see the miracles in our life? I don't know. As your pastor, I don't know. That woman, Sister Annie, loved God so much she didn't care what people thought of her. She loved God so much she sang with a guitar that wasn't tuned. And God blessed her with three businessmen to be saved that day. I've made the comment to you a few times by the name of a guy named Bill Wilson. And April gets mad at me. I won't say it. He was not the most handsome guy. Can I say it that way? I used to say he was the ugliest man I knew. But April says I'm not allowed to say that no more. Oh, I did? Huh. I believe it was 13. His mom took him to the beach in Daytona, Florida. And said, I'll be back. And left him there. 3 days later, the Assembly of God Church found out that there was a boy wandering the beach, and the Assembly of God Church took him in, opened up a Sunday school room, and that became his house, and they raised him. And he pastored the world's largest Sunday school. That was the title, the world's largest Sunday school. Not church, Sunday school. I was doing a co-conference with him. I was the expert in children's praise and worship. I'm saying that in tongue-in-cheek. I was supposedly the out-of-town expert in praise and worship for kids. And they had brought him in to teach about Sunday school. And they brought him some special singers, a trio, and they were singing the song, Giving My Best to You, Lord. You know it, David. Giving my best to you, Lord, da-da-da. And he grabbed the microphone from him and said, sit down, you haven't given nothing for God. He just got word that he lost another Sunday school teacher that was the eighth one to murder for that year. His disposition was different, wasn't it? So I asked him, Billy, when did you hear the call to go to Harlem? He said, Stevie, I never heard the call to go to Harlem. I said, what do you mean you didn't hear the call to go? Why are you in Harlem? He said, I saw the need. I saw the need. See, the day we see the need, but let somebody else do it. We see somebody needs Jesus, but we'll let somebody else do it. We see the situation that they need to be prayed for, but let somebody else do it. I said last week in Sunday school that the Apostle Paul was addicted to Jesus Christ. I've been praying that God makes me addicted to Jesus Christ. I said it in Sunday school, and since most of you weren't there, I follow chess, C-H-E-S-S, chess. And I was listening to them interview the world's champion. His name is Magnus Carlsen. He's from Norway. And they said, Magnus, what makes you so good at chess? Already considered the greatest chess player in the history of chess. They're already giving him that title. And he says, I'm addicted to chess. And it so astounded the reporter, what do you mean you're addicted to chess? He says, I wake up in the middle of the night wanting to play chess. I see people, I want to play chess. I go here, I want to play chess. I play people that's never played before. I love to play chess. And today I ask you concerning your relationship with Jesus Christ, do you want to play Jesus Christ? Is he just something that we get by with? So where are the miracles that we have? Where are the people that can say in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk? Where are the people that says in the name of Jesus, be thou henceforth removed and cast into the sea, the demonic forces at war against us? Where are the individuals that will stand in the gap and make up the hedge? Because right now we're just a nice social party. And Steve Terry is a social leader. Steve Terry is a social leader. I want to see us have miracles, James. Not little two-bit miracles. Now, I'm grateful if I have a headache and God heals a headache. Hey, can I hear an amen? If you're the one with a headache and God heals a headache, you're thrilled that God healed the headache. But I want to see bona fide miracles that the doctors say, I don't understand how that happened. We don't see that anymore, do we? I got a doctor that believes in God. We got two of them, at least two of them in this county that believe in God. They pray for you. I want to pray with you. I love that. I think that's fantastic. I love that. But what do you think about if they were to say, hey, I know you got cancer, but God's going to heal that cancer right now. In the name of Jesus, let's pray right now. In the name of Jesus, God heals that cancer. Huh? Come on now. They got Dr. Jesus on their side. That report's bad, but Dr. Jesus said, whose report are you going to believe, mine or theirs? We're the ones that can stand in the gap and make of the head. We're the ones that can say in the name of Jesus, be healed. We're the ones that says, you need to be saved. You're the one. I know that a lot of you like to have Barry do it. Let James testify. James' testimony is great. Boy, the day he talked about crawling across the floor, miracles happened that day. Miracles happened that day. Why? Because by faith he opened up the guitar case and played a three-string guitar. By faith. By faith. I want this church to be known as a church that believes. I want them to, when that little woman was walking across this building at 8 o'clock in the morning, I said to her on a Sunday morning last week, I said, oh God, when she touches that porch, let her feel the presence. When she touches that porch, let her say, oh, I feel something a little different here. I guess it was about 5 years ago. I needed something from God. You ever been there? You just needed a sign. Huh? Are you there? I need to know, are you there? I'm sorry, my faith's limited today. Will you be there for Steve today? It's a faith watch. But there are times Paul talks about it, the times our faith is tried and tested. I know there's people say, I've never been tempted. You be careful how you say that. Can I hear an amen? God can test you. He allows it. Now understand that Satan can't do anything to you without God's permission. Really, Steve? Oh, yeah. Find a whole book of the Bible about it. When God said to him, have you considered my servant Job? Satan said, hey, I would like to get a hold of Job, but you won't let me. Read it. First chapter, book of Job. And he says, oh, okay, I'm going to back off my ability to take care of him. You can do anything you want to him, but don't kill him. There's the test. Are you ready to be Job? Come on now. You said you'd handle anything. I can take it all. Be careful. Huh? Be careful. I want you to be aware that if you make it through the test, you come out victorious. Victorious. All through Corinthians, Paul was talking about being abused, being whipped, being tortured. And he said something that doesn't make any sense to me. Jerry, he said, I count it as a blessing that they think I'm willing to be offered up like this. This is cool. Now, I'll be truthful with you. Somebody stretch me out and starts taking some whips and whipping me. I can't see much blessing in that. I heard an amen. Thank you for being courageous. I don't see where anybody's getting any joy of Steve getting whipped. Definitely not Steve. Huh? But they said, I count it a blessing that I'm going through this. Do we count it a blessing to go through our trials today? Do you count it a blessing? We got people that y'all don't know that they've not been given good results or good things and more tests and that kind of stuff sitting here today. Right now. I'm blessed. We got people that's gone through hell so long they don't even know what cold water tastes like. I don't even know how many chemo Bobby's gone through. 37? 38? 37? 37 chemos. Comes out with a smile on his face. I don't know if he's being pinched by Sherry or if he's really got a smile on his face. My dad, I told you about in that same church in Aliceville, Alabama, they had a kid that every time dad went to go preach, this kid started screaming bloody murder. This young child screamed bloody murder. And of course, the mom did the right thing. She picked the baby up and she'd take him outside. There was no nursery in those days. You put the kid stayed in. How many remembers those days? We just laid on pallets and stuff. And as dad grew older, the child get older. And finally, one day, the child started yelling and screaming. The mom reached up to pick up the baby and leave. And the baby was overheard saying, Mommy, if you wouldn't pinch me so hard, I wouldn't scream so loud. See, we have to understand that our society today is looking at us. Looking at us. They're wanting to see somebody that has the ability to lay hands on the sick. I don't care if it's me. I don't care if it's Sue Alexander. It would thrill me to death if somebody said, hey, did you hear the news that Sue Alexander was in Walmart the other day and somebody was in a wheelchair and she just reached out by faith and said, in the name of Jesus, stand up, and the person was running around the whole Walmart. That thrilled me to no limit. You think I have to be involved in that? No, no, no. Let God get the glory and see what the great things he does. Too often we won't take the glory. He won't share no glory. He doesn't share his glory with anybody. Why? Because it's his. His. Let's face it. The struggle between believing in God for us where we're drowning in pain is sometimes hard. It's hard. And I want to tell you, there's a miracle, and sometimes that miracle's in your mouth. I have been told you a while ago, and I stopped to kind of lay the foundation. I've been prophesying over these chairs. What's prophecy? Bible says, Paul says, above all things, I wish you'd prophesy. Prophesy is exhorting. I've been saying under these chairs, one day you will be filled in the name of Jesus. One day souls will be coming to the altar without asking anybody to come. They'll just come running down to the altar. One day miracles will happen in this church. One day. I prophesied. Steve, I'm believing that God's going to hear me because I'm speaking it into an existence. Some of you have been beaten up. You won't speak healing in your mouth. You won't speak anything. And this man again, oh Lord, here I am. You start taking over your thoughts. You start taking over what's coming out of your mouth. You start believing that the Lord's going to answer your need. We've been sitting on, I almost said something you can't say. I almost started to say we've been sucking on hind tit too long. There I go again. Have we not? Have we not? We've been doing things on the half shell so long, we don't even know how to ask God. We don't know how to command. Buddy, Sherry, let out one. I want to show you something. This is what my dad did when he wanted me. Go for it, girl. My dad, that's how he called me. Now, I can't do it. I do it myself. I could be three blocks over. Everybody said, oh, there's Steve. Got to go. That was Dad's way of saying, it's time to come home, son. Supper's ready, whatever. I didn't have to have a cell phone. Huh? I didn't have to have it on email or Wi-Fi, and I didn't have to have my Bluetooth phone. Oh, that was my signal. It's time to come home. Because if I didn't come home, it happened one time. It was on a Wednesday night, and I didn't hear him. Boy, did I pay the consequences for that one. When he come in from church, I said, Dad, I had church already. I played your sermons. I played the music, and he got to laughing because I didn't hear him. He knew I'd show up. Oh, I still got entertained. Can I say it that way? I still got entertained. But because I knew and recognized my dad's whistle, two cards a day, we don't recognize the voice of God says that, come unto me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you. Steve, I want to. We just don't know how. Anybody ever really sought the Holy Spirit? I sought the Holy Spirit. I sought the Holy Spirit. And I remember one time I was seeking the Holy Spirit, and two old gentlemen, two saints, began to pray for me. Now, they don't pray. In those days, they didn't pray for us like we do today. Oh, my Jesus. That's how they... Can I borrow you? Come here for a second. You, the big guy. I need him. Come here. Come here. I want you to just kind of kneel right there. I'm going to hit you. Put your hands right there. I'm not going to hurt you, okay? One would be on one side and one on the other. Really. And one would say, oh, Steve, let it go. And they were hitting me harder than I'm hitting him. And the other one would be on this side and says, hang on, Steve. Hang on, Steve. And I'm being truthful. Thank you. Thank you. You can go now. I didn't hurt you, did I?
No.
Okay. Hang on, let go. I finally didn't know what to say. I was one of a sudden hanging on, the other one says, let go. Me being me stopped, and I said, hold it. Now, I'm 12, you can imagine. Which one am I supposed to do? And they both looked at me and said, one of you saying hang on, the other one says let go. Which one am I supposed to do? And they got to laughing. You can imagine. Finally, they're trying to figure out what to say. One of them says, let go of your past and hang on to the Lord. Can I repeat that? Let go of what's going on in your past, because you can never change that, and hang on to God. Today, I'm telling you the same thing. Let go of what's been in the past and start grabbing a hold of God so you can do mighty things for the Lord. So you can do mighty things for God. He wants you to. He just don't want me or Chris or Barry. He wants you to start doing mighty things. Find it perfectly in Acts in closing. Beautiful in Acts. I think one of the most beautiful scriptures in all the Bibles in Acts has to do with lay people. Grab a hold of this. The disciples were a touch arrogant. Can I just be truthful with you? First problem in the book of the New Testament, the widow women. The Grecian widow women weren't being taken care of because we're talking about what? Oh, please. Thank you. The first problem in the New Testament church is about, now you're learning. Huh? The Grecian widow women aren't being taken care of properly, Peggy. So there's an uprising. So what do the disciples do? This is too cool. Well, it is not proper for us to forget the word of God in praying. Huh? And wait on tables. That's what the word says. But David, am I right? Not right for us to wait on tables. We're men of God. Seek you out seven men now, full of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Ghost, and let them be your administrators. And this was good. The Bible says, and this pleased every one of them. And we find that one of them was a guy named Stephen. Supposedly, that's who I was named after. I have no idea why. I've never had the courage, and now Mom probably doesn't remember why. But she could. And the Bible says Stephen was full of faith and wisdom, and many great miracles and wonders and signs were done under Stephen. Now, apostles are, now that we don't hear any miracles done by the apostles, we hear them done by the layperson. You. Steve, I've never laid my hands on anybody. I've kind of touched your prayers are what's going to bring people to salvation. Your prayers are going to see those that need to be saved. Your prayers are going to be, you're the ones that says, in the name of Jesus, you rise up and walk. Because it ain't you. Get it out of your head. It ain't you. When they're healed and saved, it's not you. It's Jesus Christ. You're the instrument. You're the salt shaker. You're the vessel, the Bible says. The Bible says some vessels are of honor, some are dishonor. We're tired of being just vessels. Be a vessel of honor and watch God use you. And watch where the miracles are because they're with you. They're with you. Don't lean on Chris, Lori. Don't lean on Barry. Don't dare lean on Steve Terry. Huh? It's okay to say, will you pray for me? It's okay to say that, but where's your faith? Abraham said to the guys, the kids, the boy and I will be back soon. See, he probably thought that God was going to raise him from the dead. It didn't matter because God had promised him that his seed would be as the stars of the sky. So he said, God's not going to lie. So God's going, I'm going to kill him and God's going to bring him back. Huh? He said, God said, now I know you love me more than you do your boy. Faith. That's why he's in the oracles of faith. Heroes of faith. What chapter and what book is the Heroes of Faith? I'm testing you. What book? Book of Hebrews. What chapter? Chapter 11. The same one that talks about Abraham being full of faith mentions a little lady. David, I'm ready for you to go. I'll preach on this all night. I'm tired of, I'm telling you, I want Sandra Oakley's sister. Anybody know Sandra Oakley's sister? She got on to me at the wedding last week and had to write me an apology. She wrote me a card and had a type written inside. Y'all have fun. She'll be here in a little bit. I just wanted to apologize about your 15-minute sermons. I was just teasing Steve. And I was talking about this, that our faith needs to be encouraged by the lay people. That's you and I. Would you stand? Now, I know that some of you have incredible needs. I want to see some faith in action. I don't want you to depend on me anymore. Will I pray with you? Undeniably. That's what I'm supposed to do. My job as a pastor is to pray for you, to lift you up, sermon, bring people to Jesus Christ. Go visit the sick. Take care of the homeless. That's what I'm supposed to do. Right? I'm supposed to do. Can I hear an amen? The best pastors aren't always the ones that scream and holler. Great at preachers. The ones that I classified, I've had two people that were my pastors that were pastors. And my dad wasn't one of them. Behind the pulpit, my dad, maybe there was no equal. I can't even carry his briefcase. People ask me, do you preach like your dad? No. I can't carry his briefcase. Preaching wise. But a pastor is one that does what he's supposed to do. You are a pastor. You are a minister of Jesus Christ. You're to do what you're supposed to do for God and for the glory of God. For the glory of God. So if you've got somebody right now, I know there are. I know that I go to the aisles. That's what I'm doing. But I want more than just Steve Terry to pray over the needs of the people. I want some of you that your faith's going to get on. And I want some of you to say, oh, baby, you're fixing to have your need recovered. In the name of Jesus, I want it. Steve, why do you do this? Because no man can get the glory. No man can get the glory. If Jim and Donna come up here and Donna's blind, hypothetically, Donna's blind. And I lay my hands on her, And suddenly she's healed. Who gets the glory? Now, God's supposed to do, but who gets the glory? Yeah, unfortunately, because I laid my hands on her. How stupid. You think I can heal her? This other way, nobody gets the glory but God. That's cool. Why? Because he's the only one that deserves it. So if you have a need, I feel it. I feel it. Oh, it's the first time I've ever felt it walking up the stairs. Some of you, your faith has picked up. I felt it when I walked up the steps. It's your faith. You're starting to grab a hold of it. Hey, we can do this. I want you to go to an aisle that you have a situation, a problem. That it only is a God thing. When this thing, this is a God situation. God's going to have to do this one. There you go. Got a few moving by faith. It's faith. Faith. See, faith sees the unseen. Sees the unseen. Now, I want us to kind of move a circle around them. Kind of keep the proper distance. One day that's going to over with. I want some of you to kind of move around where you can put your hands in their face a little bit, you know. Move, just don't stand there. Huh? Who gets the glory? I love it. How many says, Steve, I'm starting to feel a little faith in me today. There you go, I got a couple. Steve, I'm feeling a little faith in me today. That, if you feel it, I want you to start, I mean when you pray, you start waving your hands. Let's do it. Father, in the name of Jesus, where are the miracles? Are here today, God. They're right here. They're right at Prince's Chapel. In the name of Jesus, we speak healing to those that are needed healing. In the name of Jesus, we speak peace. Let the Prince of Peace breathe peace to them right now. In the name of Jesus, those that are needed difficulties resolved socially, economically, health-wise, we speak it in the name of Jesus that you will take care of it. As the centurion said, speak the word only and it'll done. It's done. In the name of Jesus, make it happen, I pray. This moment forth, this day forth, mark the calendar, October the 18th, on a Sunday that things started changing for their lives. That now they will speak against the evil one approaching them. They'll reach out and grab a hold of God. Grab a hold of Jesus. Speak it. Speak it into existence. Speak it into existence in Jesus' name. Say it, that word, in Jesus' name. Say it in Jesus' name. Take authority over this situation. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I'm going to thank you all for being here today. As I said before, there are some offering pans. If you have to give to God and you wish to give to God, you do it joyfully. Remember to use proper thing. Share the good news of Jesus Christ. What did I say? Share the good news of Jesus Christ. And watch souls be saved and transformed. Amen? To whom the Son has set free, we are what? Free indeed. God bless you today.